Good morning, everyone, wherever you're listening or watching today. Welcome to Fisherwick's weekly streaming on YouTube and Facebook. And welcome to those who are listening on the phone, because you can now phone in to listen to the audio part of this service. And bear in mind that that is available throughout the week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, until the next one is uploaded for the phone service. Can I say a big hi to Dave, Reverend Dave Gray, and family who are taking a well-earned break. Dave has been leading the leadership team of the church since January and has been guiding us in the steps through the vacancy and inspiring us along the way. We thank Dave and wish you God's blessing where you are today. This week we come to the third in our series, Life on the Road, and we're at Psalm 122. Let's see what we can learn about our life on our road from this psalm today. Here's how it begins. I rejoiced with those who said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord." And while we cannot physically meet together in our premises, let's realize and remember that it's the body of Christ, we the people, who make the congregation of God. So let us worship together where we are. Let us sing his praise. And we'll go straight to that today, because I want to make some important announcements to the congregation, which I've been asked to do, and then lead us in prayer with those things in mind. Let us sing to God's praise. Let us worship God.
Down on our knees.
This has been a lengthy period of change and uncertainty, not simply because of the COVID virus, but in the processing of the vacancy of this congregation. Let me tell you that much has been happening behind the scenes. And in connection with that, the members ought to have now received a draft questionnaire response generated by the elders. If you didn't get one of those, then contact Danielle in the church office. Everyone in the congregation is encouraged to participate in this process. We want you to read the elders' responses, then submit your own comments to any of the questions or indeed to all of the questions. The congregation needs to be at the heart of this process. And Dave and the elders want to take everyone's views into consideration. Now, this is about God's plan, God's vision for the future. And it's about your vision connecting with that. And so we need to be able to say to a prospective minister, here's where we are as a congregation in the Lord's mission. Here's what we would like to achieve in Jesus' name. Can you identify with that? Can you share our passion? Will you teach and will you lead us in the direction that we believe God wants us to go? Now, there's a time limit on this. Can you please have your response in by the end of July? That gives the time for the elders to compile the summary of that and to give you feedback, and then to advance this to presbytery level and on to linkage commission. We commend that to you. Now, the second matter I've been asked to mention is the need for a temporary office administrator to cover maternity leave. Details of that are on the web page, or you can receive from Linda, the clerk of session. And thirdly, since we will continue to do online services for the foreseeable future, our virtual choir is open to consider new members. I trust you'll give that your thoughts, those of you that would wish to be part of that. You can get details of how that works from the weekly news sheet. Now let's join our hearts together in prayer. Let's consider these things. Let us all pray. Lord our God, we remember today that you do not dwell in buildings that are made by human effort, but in the hearts and lives of your people. Once we were not your people, but Lord, most holy, you set a plan in motion. You sought us, even when we were dead in sin, with no thought of you. By your mercy, you lifted us and clothed us with the righteousness of Christ, your beloved Son, and you restored us to yourself. Now, as the body of Christ, the church, we seek to worship you in spirit and in truth, and with gladness in our hearts. We praise you for all that you've done, and for all that you have in store for us. Our lives are in your hands. And while, Lord, we are physically separated, we recognize our fellowship and our togetherness with you and with one another. Lord, for these matters that we've just announced and spoken of, we ask for your guidance and wisdom. And may our hearts and minds be tuned to your purpose for our future together. Lord, lead us. Lead us to the people you've already appointed for your great purpose for Fisherwick Church. May your name be glorified in all of your kingdom and in this place. Grant us pardon for our many sins. Accept our prayers and our praise. Give us attentive ears to your word and sincerity of heart as we pray the model prayer you have left us, saying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. In just a moment, we'll be reading from God's word in Psalm 122. Our other day we'll be doing that. Directly after that, we will have something for our younger worshippers. And then a special treat for you, for all of you. One of our senior members, Mr. Ernest Huntley, reads an inspiring poem called The Touch of the Master's Hand.
This morning's reading is Psalm 122, a song of ascent, and the reading is taken from the King James Version. Psalm 122. I rejoiced with those who said to me, "Let us go to the house of the Lord. Our feet are standing in your gates, Jerusalem." Jerusalem is built like a city that is closely compacted together. This is where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to praise the name of the Lord, according to the statute given to Israel. There stand the thrones of judgment, the thrones of the house of David. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you be secure. May there be peace within your walls and security within your citadels. For the sake of my family and friends, I will say, peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your prosperity. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, boys and girls. I got a text from Danny earlier in the week asking me to do the children's address. And this is something that I've never done before. But I said yes, and I was thinking about this week and about the Psalms of Ascent that we're going to be learning about throughout the summer. Can you believe that we are now 17 weeks into online services, and they've been really fun, haven't they? This week's Psalm is Psalm 122. And I'm going to tell you how it starts. So reading from the Message Bible, it starts like this. When they said, "Let's go to the house of God," my heart leapt for joy. And now we're here, O Jerusalem, inside Jerusalem's walls. So David had written this psalm, and for a long time afterwards, people were using this psalm among the others as a form of worship. And I was thinking about it, and it's such a long time since we've been inside the walls of our house of God out of Fisherwick, and yet we have had a great time worshiping God throughout lockdown. So I thought I would share with you some ways the Scullion family have found to worship God when church has been physically closed. One of the big ways is actually through this service. So on a Sunday morning, we all sit together, and Niamh and Anna's nanny and papa down in the south of Ireland tune in, and their cousins also, and also their nanny and papa up in the north coast. And we know that there are lots of people in Fisherwick worshipping together in the Sunday service, so that's one of the ways. Another way that we worship God is when we're about to have our evening meal. So the four of us sit together and we thank God and worship God really for all that he's given us. And sometimes we make up our own prayers, and sometimes we use this prayer dice, and Anna's going to read one of the prayers that we've used to worship God.
Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for our daily food. Amen.
Another thing that we've been doing is just thanking God for his beautiful creation. And on Monday, we climbed in the Mourne Mountains.
And me and Nanny went up a little walk and we were at the top of this mountain, and there was this wall, and it had there was rocks along the floor, so we picked up a rock and put it on the wall and prayed for all of our family members and friends.
When we were up in the mountain, we really appreciated how much nature there was and the sheep that we saw.
And over the last month or so, we have watched the amazing transformation from caterpillar to butterfly. And we're going to let them out today.
Yeah.
God is all around us. Let's open our eyes and worship him in the things that he has created. I am
touch of the Master's hand. 'Twas battered and scarred, and the auctioneer thought it scarcely worth his while to waste much time on the old violin, but he held it up with a smile. "What am I bidden, good folk?" he cried. "Who'll start the bidding for me? A dollar? A dollar? Then two. Only two? $2. Who'll make it three? Going for three, but no." From the room far back, a grey-haired man came forward and picked up the bow. Then, wiping the dust from the old violin and tightening the loosened strings, he played a melody pure and sweet, as a caroling angel sings. The music ceased, and the auctioneer, with a voice that was quiet and low, said, "Now, what am I bid for the old violin?" And he held it up with the bow. $1,000? Who'll make it two? 2,000? Who'll make it three? 3,000 once, 3,000 twice, and going, going, gone," cried he. The people cheered, but some of them cried, "We do not understand. What changed its worth?" Quick came the reply, "The touch of the Master's hand." And many a man with life out of tune, and battered and scarred with sin, is auctioned cheap to a thoughtless crowd, much like the old violin. A mess of pottage, a glass of wine, a game, and he travels on. He's going once and going twice, he's going and almost gone. But the Master comes, and the foolish crowd never can quite understand the worth of a soul and the change that's wrought by the touch of the Master's hand.
Thank you.
Wasn't that great from Ernest? What a difference it makes to have the touch of the Master's hand. Could I just say at this point, thank you to all who contribute to these services. Not forgetting, of course, those who work behind the scenes, piecing all the parts together and uploading it. Let me tell you, that's no mean feat. Now, what about this psalm? Can I ask you, what's the most exciting part of going on a holiday for you? Is it the preparation and the anticipation? Is it the starting of the journey when you set out? The closing up and that feeling of you're on your way? Or what about the arrival? Maybe you're going through the gates of the caravan park, or you're arriving in the apartment and you're setting down the bags and you're looking out the window and the view is fantastic. You've arrived. Great. Psalm 122 gives us a sense of that arrival feeling. That feeling of we're here and there's exhilaration and realization we've made it. Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. That's what verse 2 says. A kind of wow factor. The leaving, the forsaking, the struggling, all the difficulties along the way has made it worthwhile. We're here. These life on the road psalms remind us as followers of Christ that we're on a journey. And this one in particular reminds us of where we are going and indeed what we are right now. In the first of the series, Psalm 120, Dave led us to consider the futility of the world and its existence without God. If God is absent, then we're left destitute and lost. So we look back at where we have been and what we've been called to forsake in repentance and faith. Remember the cry from that psalm, deliver my soul, O Lord. Deliver me from all of this. Deliver me from everything that wars against my contentment in you. Every journey, we say, begins with a single step. And as we look back, as Dave reminded us, we look back and realise that our Christian journey needs to have a beginning. And that begins with a sincere turning in repentance and faith towards the living God for our salvation. In the second in the series, Danny took us to Psalm 121, which reminds us of God's faithfulness along life's way. Where does our help come from? Our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. We cry out for deliverance. God calls us to forsake and follow us, but does he leave us alone? Not at all. Although there are tough times and difficult times, God remains an ever-present help in our struggles. Does he leave us alone for the journey? Not at all. He's the keeper of Israel who does not slumber nor sleep. Now, the Jewish pilgrims were instructed to rally and keep, amongst all the other feasts and rituals, these three major ones, that of Passover, and of Pentecost, and the Feast of Booths that reminded them of their wanderings in the wilderness during the time of Moses. So these songs of ascent are believed to be used as teaching aids for the journey. They no doubt bolstered the purpose and morale of those travellers and focused their minds. I'm sure they kept the kids occupied with the reasons and purpose for the journey. Now, in my mind's eye, I see weary travellers. Maybe they've trudged 20, 30, 40 miles along a difficult road with difficulties all around them. They've come from somewhere remote and they round a corner and there ahead is Jerusalem. Maybe the head of the party says, I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? And from behind, the crowd that's with him says, our help is in the name of the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I imagine that little group's pace quickens as they see the city, they see the destination, And then at verse 2 of our psalm today, the rejoicing is there. Our feet are standing within your gates, O Jerusalem. We've made it. And they take in the view and sigh a sigh of relief. We've arrived. Jerusalem, they say, is built like a city that is closely compacted together. This is where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to praise the name of the Lord according to the statutes given to Israel. Momentarily they look back. The sacrifice was worth it. I'm glad I'm here. I'm glad I left behind what I left. I'm glad I came. And I thank God for those who said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. And I thank God for those who helped me along the way and sustained me and kept me going with their encouragement. I'm glad they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Now, when you're on holiday, do you still send postcards? Now, it's probably the case that Facebook and the likes have superseded all of that. But some postcards you used to get had several different views, and they were a way of saying, look where we are. When I was teaching back a number of years ago, there was a retired colleague who used to send us a card from some sunny place, and she timed it to arrive when we were all starting back to school in September. But verses 2 to 5 of this psalm kind of give us a word picture postcard with the message, look where we are. Our feet are within Jerusalem's gates. We stand within a compact boundary. It's a fortified city. It's secure. Here we feel safe from enemy attack. This is King David's Jerusalem, and it may have been small, but it was very significant. This, you see, is the capital of a united Israel. As yet, there's no temple, but there's the king's palace, and the king has assigned a special sacred place for the Ark of the Covenant, which represents God's abiding presence in the midst of the people. The psalmist finds this breathtaking. Look where we once were. Look where we are now. Zion's Hill, the city of our God. We feel physically closer to God here. We feel the awe, we feel the wonder of all that God has done. He has called us here from across the land. This people group were once slaves in Egypt, but God delivered them. Despite rebellion over many generations, God never forsook them. Enemies sought to conquer or overrun them, but here they stand within Jerusalem. Here they gather within Jerusalem. Here they are, the community of God's rescued people, a nation that God has made, his kingdom. The Lord has indeed been gracious. In this passage, I see and hear echoes of Paul's writing in Ephesians, as Paul declares the present reality of those who are in Christ. Listen to this from Ephesians 1. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us to be adopted as his sons through Jesus Christ, in accordance with the pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely lavished on us, the ones he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace he has lavished upon us with all wisdom and understanding. And he has made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times have reached their fulfillment, to bring all things in heaven and in earth under one head, even Christ. Look where we've come from. Look where we are right now. But tell me this, despite all of that, you sometimes feel like you're a lone believer. Maybe where you are, you're the only Christian. Does it look like the Christian church is a minority to you? Or indeed that it's in decline? Numbers sometimes would suggest that. It's easy, therefore, to get discouraged and to lose sight of some of these great realities. And I guess doing church in this fashion at home hasn't helped us either. But verse 4 of this psalm reminds me of something which is really, really encouraging. The community of God's people is not something small or local. We're not a quaint or a shrinking huddle holding on to some old traditions. The psalmist realizes this too. He says, this is where the tribes go up, the tribes of the Lord, to praise the name of the Lord. They may have been a minority in the village where they were, and you may be a minority or feel that where you are. But when the tribes gather, when the people gather, they realize afresh the community of God's people is no small thing. Some years ago, we used to be visiting London, maybe to visit our son or just to simply to have a weekend away. And we would go to All Souls Church in Langham Place. That's the church beside the BBC buildings where the One Show is filmed. One Sunday we were in the gallery of that church, and I have to say the emotion of the occasion just overtook me. The congregation were singing the hymn that goes like this: I cannot tell why he whom angels worship should set his love upon the sons of men, or why as shepherds he should seek the wandering to bring them back, I know not how or when. It was the third verse that really caught me. It says this: but this I know, the sky will fill with rapture as myriad, myriad human voices sing, and earth to heaven and heaven to earth will answer at last, the Saviour, Saviour of the world is King. I have to say there was a lump in my throat as I scanned round that auditorium. There were Asians, there were Indians, there were Chinese, Japanese, Europeans, Africans, no doubt Americans and Canadians and Australians, the myriad and myriad of human voices singing. It was a foretaste, I thought, of heaven itself. And in that moment, I appreciated more than ever that I am part, we are part of something which is the worldwide church of God. Many in Christ had gathered. It was like a snapshot or a foretaste of a new Jerusalem. We have arrived, and yet we had to go home. It's the tribes of the Lord who come together to praise the one who rescued us and who has brought us to the place where we are. The Apostle Peter puts it like this, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. There's just so much thought that is provoked by this psalm, this life on the road psalm. Look what God has called you from. Look where we are in Christ. And look ahead to where we are going, because all of this is merely a foretaste of the fullness of Christ's kingdom yet to come. Like all good holidays, it comes the time to pack up and to return. If it's been a good holiday, then of course no one wants to go home. But these Psalms remind us that we are on the road and we are continuing on that journey. And one day there will be an end. And so as people we gather, and as people we worship, and we fellowship, and we feel renewed when we do that. But we know that it's temporary. And we know that God has yet more to complete, even in our time. So after our gatherings, we return to where God has placed us, to the towns and to the villages where we live, to the streets and the very houses, and into our workplaces, our colleges, our schools. What do these pilgrims that we are thinking of take back with them? And what should we take with us as we continue the journey? Look at the remaining verses. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. May those who love you be secure. May there be peace within your walls and security within your citadels. The prayer is for those that they leave behind. It's for their fellow travellers on the road. The prayer is also for the continuation of Jerusalem. Because as the holy city remains, God's peace, God's prosperity, and the security that that brings remains across the land. For the sake of my brothers and my friends, I will say this: peace be within you. For the sake of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek your prosperity. Our prayer, therefore, for the road ought to be for the peace of God to remain with and within each one of us. We pray too for the preservation of the Church of Jesus Christ until his purpose is complete. And then he comes and takes us home, and he ushers in his eternal kingdom. So as we conclude, what would you take from this psalm and from the others for life on your road? I trust you will take encouragement because of all that God has done for you as you look back and reflect upon that. I trust that you will find that there's peace in your heart as you realise God's faithfulness now and his purpose on into the future and the eternal purpose and destiny he has in mind. May there be a realisation that you're not alone and that the Church of Jesus Christ, his kingdom, is no small or insignificant thing. We're not a minority when we are in Christ. And may you therefore have motivation to live for that kingdom, to live for the sake of Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, until he comes. May his peace remain upon each one of us. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. May we come together to pray for our congregation, community and the world. Father God, thank you. You are our God, whose character exudes grace, strength, love, challenge, forgiveness, tolerance, and patience. The frequent glib reply of fine thanks to the question, how are you, often disguises what is really going on, but you know, nothing is hidden from your compassionate eyes. Today, Lord, we bring members of our congregation who are ill or anxious about relatives, people who are struggling with isolation, depression, relationship problems, employment issues, or business worries. Even the smallest of disappointments or feelings of foolishness over an incident can throw us off guard. Lord of comfort, come. Bring blessing and strength. Fill the emptiness with reassurance that you are there and will remain there, whatever the outcome. You do not come and go. Holy Spirit, we pray for those who have suffered bereavement. Please be with them in their shock and grief, and walk with them through the long days and nights of loneliness. We also thank you for answered prayers. In thankfulness, we celebrate with friends and relatives in their relief for family members who have recovered. Lord, we extend our prayers to our community. Over the past few weeks, we have been gradually coming out of lockdown to a different life. Thank you for bringing us through this period. It has been difficult. For some, it has brought life-changing situations where years of employment or the building up of a business have just gone in a trice. We pray for those still on furlough, but who have learnt there's a dark cloud looming over their future. Lord, may help and financial advice be available where needed. Looking forward, we pray for the preparations in the reopening of Fisherwick. It's not just a case of turning the key in the lock. There are many practicalities to be considered. We extend our thanks to those responsible for putting everything in order. Thank you for the online services. They've taken so much work, and our congregation has been held together by them, the newsletters and the meals. Blessings to all our staff for their work, dedication and commitment. We turn our attention to other cities and countries who are still bound by COVID-19. Lord, be with them in their frustration and dismay as their glimmer of light has been put out by an extended lockdown. Lord, we also bring you your people who are in danger of the virus, where country does not have the same high standard of health care. In particular, we think of refugee camps and war-torn countries where they have problems enough without this. Finally, Lord, we pray for the leaders of our country. They have a difficult job and we demand so much from them. Yet they are human beings with sensitivities. Lord, thank you for their work, and we pray for guidance for them in making decisions. We bring these matters to you, Lord, knowing that you are there. Amen.
The Life on the Road series continues next Sunday with Psalm 124. Mr. Peter Scullion will be opening that up for us. Usual time, 11 o'clock. Across all the platforms, YouTube, Facebook, and now the telephone. Why not send in a video clip, a greeting, or a photograph of where you have been listening to the service, if it's somewhere different, or indeed, if you are one of our distant listeners. As we conclude today, you look back on your journey and see where the Lord has brought you from? Will you look around you at where the Lord has placed you right now? And will you look straight ahead at what the Lord has in store for you and the eternity that he wants to bring you to? Realize this. It's all by the grace of God. God's grace has brought you safe thus far. His grace will lead you home. Let's pray the benediction together, the words of the grace. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.